Today in the news, we got some Intel slides leaked, a benchmarking app, and a light switch. What's up guys, I'm Snows, and this is your boot sequence. Let's get started with Intel. Looks like those leaks you saw yesterday, well, yeah, they're fake. As much as I thought that they made sense, a new leak from XFastest, a much more reliable source, has popped out with internal documents showing more information on Comet Lake S, and it kind of contradicts yesterday's leak. These three presentation slides don't give us the full lineup, but they do align with older leaks for specs of the new 10th gen CPUs. As with any leaks, especially yesterday's, this information is to be taken with a grain of salt. If we take a look at the platform details, we see the socket, which is LGA1200, as compared to 1159 on the fake leak. LGA1200 was also in a previous leak, accompanied by Intel's new chipset family name. That new name was the 400 and 495 chipset series, and the 400 is confirmed by this new leak from XFastest. Looking at power, we finally see a departure from the 95W TDP for a more power-hungry 125W for the enthusiast platform. Now I know what you're gonna say. Intel always uses more than 95W. Well, that is due to motherboard vendors exceeding the Intel specs. Yes, it uses more than 95W on pretty much any motherboards, but it can run at 95W, even though performance takes a hit. The corporate slash mainstream line will sport 65W and the low power line 35W. In terms of I/O, we see pretty much the exact same thing as with Z390 and Coffee Lake. Up to 24 PCIe 3.0 lanes on the chipset, 16 lanes on the CPU, and up to 10 USB 3.1 ports, etc., etc. We do get confirmation of the 10 core 20 thread CPUs, but that we knew from the roadmaps too. All in all, it looks like Comet Lake S will still be the refresh we expect, but the main factor that is left to decide its value is still completely unknown. That's the price. I guess we'll have to wait until Q1 of next year to get more info, but if you were in the market for a CPU right now, do yourself a favor and just buy a Ryzen 3000 CPU. It's a no-brainer right now. By the way, I will be updating yesterday's video title and thumbnail to make sure it is clear that the leak is fake. Next up, did you want an all-in-one benchmarking app that can give you not only your FPS, but your rendered FPS, your displayed FPS, the 90th, 95th, 99th percentile average FPS, give you your power consumption, your total board power, and identify things like screen tearing, VSync, and whether you're in full screen or windowed mode? Well, it looks like your friendly neighborhood Nvidia just released this app, and it's called FrameView. Now, I've gotta say, this is a pretty neat tool, but Nvidia is making a pretty big mistake here. If you're someone who just wants to check out what's happening with their GPUs, that's perfectly fine. But this will and should probably never be used for reviewers for two reasons. First, there's too much politics involved. I mean, you're really going to use an Nvidia app to benchmark your AMD GPU? What a shill, right? Second, it's not open source, so even if it's accurate, someone should be able to go in there and check out what's going on under the hood. At least there is something available for someone who is just curious. Let's move on to Nintendo, and there's more than the Switch Lite here, okay? But first, the Switch Lite. Nintendo announced it yesterday morning, and the thing looks pretty amazing for a handheld. I say for a handheld because I don't think that it should be a main console for anyone. I mean, you can't connect it to a TV, the Joy-Cons aren't detachable, the rumble is gone, I mean the HD rumble is gone. It's basically the next step in Nintendo handhelds, effectively replacing the 3DS. I say this because Nintendo themselves confirmed that no new first-party Nintendo games were going to come to the 3DS. So yeah, if you want a Nintendo console that you can enjoy outside and at home with friends, get the regular Switch, which brings me to my next topic. The old Switch looks like it's getting a slight upgrade. Nintendo submitted a Class 2 permission change to the FCC, which allows them to make changes to an existing device without having to redo all of these certifications. In that request, three things are noted: a change in SoC, a change in NAND memory type, and a PCB change because of the previous two changes. Now, we don't know exactly what those changes are, but rumors are that this is the same Tegra X1 design, although the exploits are patched out, and it might have a die shrink. As for the new NAND memory type, I guess they might be going for a higher layer count on their TLC NAND, but that's just me speculating. That new Tegra X1 chip though, it might give you better resolutions at more constant frame rates. But I guess we'll have to wait and see if somebody can do a deep dive on the new version of the Switch when it comes out. It's probably still going to be named the regular Switch, they're just gonna be changing the insides without changing the whole branding. Anyways guys, that is pretty much it for the news today. Hopefully you've enjoyed. If you got any questions, drop them down below. As usual, you can click right here to see the latest video right here. To subscribe to the channel, it would be greatly appreciated. Stay frosty, my dudes, and I'll see you on the next one. By the way, if you guys have any suggestions for a deeper dive on a video, just leave it down below. I'll take a look. Take care.